Hello and welcome to today's tech tip tutorial for Edgecam undercut machining. Right now on the screen we have a file open in Designer, which is our CAD package for Edgecam, and we want to look into some areas before we go to manufacture some areas of the component. For example, the area we're going to focus on to machine is this fillet area down there. But if we put this part now into a top view, we have a bit of a scenario here where we have like an undercut situation where a stickout is sticking over the fillet area. So we can't do this with 3 axes, but we want to do it with 5 axes. And how do we do it in 5 axes is what we're going to address in this video. So if I just move the part over, you can see clearly that this would cause some situation where we would require tool tilting, for example. So we will definitely require 5 axis machining to achieve the area of machining that fillet. So in Designer, we have a really cool tool for undercut. So we just activate the undercut area. You can then see clearly the red zone is where the undercut is taking place on that part. And that's where the real headache is at the moment. So that because we can't achieve the 5 axis machine. So this is what we're gonna address. So let's move over to Edgecam. So now that we're in the Edgecam environment, we've clearly generated the toolpath as shown on the screen already for 3 axes. So I'm just going to right click and simulate now, so we can see clearly where we will obviously get collision at that point there. And this is where the crash will take place if we wanted to use 3 axes. So now, even though we are using an advanced 5-axis cycle, inside Edgecam, you can use a 5-axis cycle for 3 axes, 4 axes, and 5 axes. The reason being, it makes it more intuitive for the user to get used to similar settings on a regular basis, and it's quite easy to switch between 3, 4, and 5 axis machining. So let's just open up the cycle quickly and go to the tool axis control command. And right here, you can see in the output format, we have set it to 3 axis. But over in the surface paths area, we are using the morph between two curves settings. And this can now be used for 4 axis and 5 axis, which is what we're going to do. But it's just wanting to show that you can start off with a basic output of 3 axis just to get the toolpath onto the surface and then configure it from that point. So let's look at that area of the tool axis control, what we can do to address this scenario. So now we're going to look at the next toolpath where we using tool axis control to implement some 5-axis behavior. And we'll open up the cycle, tool axis control. Now with the tool axis control, we have set the tool axis for tilt to a fixed angle 2 axis. What this means, the tool is tilted from a fixed angle Z, Y, or X towards the surface normal direction with a specific angle. But the method is recommended normally for rotational components in a 4-axis machining environment. So we have set it even though we want to use a 5-axis output. And we want to get the tool with that fixed angle through the Z-axis. And if I just cancel this now and then simulate the toolpath, you can see a clear motion of the tool tilting away around the undercut area or around that stick out area of the component. Now, how did we implement that if we haven't even justified a motion. We've only set it to Z axis with the fix, so it doesn't add up. Now, if we go to the gauge check area of the cycle, we have implemented two checks. First check is we implementing the lower area of the carbide tool, which is the ball nose area, to a check surface. And if I select this area, you can see that is the check surface that we've selected, as well as that surface. Then if we come to the second check option, where we select now the whole tool with a different strategy, and we're asking the tool to tilt the tool automatic. Whether it is a lead or lag or a side tilt, we don't really care. We just want the software to look at that motion for us to remove if there's any collision. So if we go to the box now, you can now see the areas which we've picked for the tool to be checked against and then tilt away from those areas. And that is exactly what we've done to get that motion of the tool. So a lot of users will take a bit of time to get to this setting, and it becomes a very well known user of the product who will be able to do these kind of settings. So to make things easy, there are a number of ways how we can justify an edge count on how you can control the tool without having to do all the surface selecting and things like that. And this is what we're going to look at, and that is called a tilt curve with wireframe geometry. So let's have a look at that. So now let's look at the following solution or option that you can use by using tilt curves. And using tilt curves is a great way to fully control the behavior of a tool. And it normally tends to provide a better control of the tool as well as the surface results. And as a contact point will always stay and be more consistent on the surface. So it is a great way of doing file access machine. This is what we want to cover now on this toolpath, is the tilt curve. So first of all, how did we manage to get that tilt curve there? So we have created the tilt curve through the feature tab, use the geometry, and then we use the edges command, and we use continuous or it can be individual. And then you can just go and pick the edges and you create geometry from that. And once we've created that geometry, which is the red geometry you can see, we have then gone over into the setup tab and go over to the offset command. And we've offsetted that, as you can see over there, by 30 mil. How did you get to 30 mil? That's the next question. And that was by measuring from the center point of the bottom fillet to the center point of the opposite fillet. And that value there was 60. So now we know by offsetting it by 30 mil, it's right in the center of that open slot area or that open area on the part. And that's why we use 30 mil. When we've used the 30 mil then, and we then go back into the machining environment where we use the tilt curve, and we'll open up the cycle, and in the tool axis control, we are using tilted through a curve, and we use closest point. And with this method, the tool will always stay pointed to the geometry curve when selected, and this will move it at all times. And that's a great way of controlling the tool. And you almost see a preview of how the tool can behave or how the tool will tilt when you use this method. So when we go and cancel that and we simulate the toolpath, we can see that the tool is now moving through the center of that curve at all times. So let's just go back to that and just move it slowly all the way back. And you can see constantly the center of the curve hitting the center of the back end of the holder. And that's a great way of controlling that. But when we've used the 30 mil offset, we realize that, hold on, we can create less tilt. So this is now something always to remember, is the shorter the line, the greater the tilt. The longer the line, the less the tool will tilt. And that's the same with positioning. If you put the tool the curve lower, you will get more tilt. If you raise the tilt, or if you raise the curve, you will get less tilt. So that is always something to remember. So the first method was just to offset it, to get to the center of 30 mil, and then use that method in there. Then we will now look at the next toolpath where we've moved the tilt curve. Now in this toolpath, we use the same tilt curve, however, we have lifted it in the Z stroke by 10 mil. So under the layers, if I go to the layers, you can see I've actually renamed them so that we can cover them exactly. You can see the 10 mil shift. Why did it shift it? And this is what we were saying from the previous result, where there was quite a lot of space between the back ends and this area here. So now by lifting the tool, the back end will get closer to this area, less movement will take place. So let's just hide that tool curve that we've used in the previous cycle, and we come to this one that we are using now. So if you open up the cycle, it was exactly the same as the previous one, where we've used tilted through curve and we selected the curve with the close point. If I then go and simulate that, we can see the tool clearly tilting closer to the holder. So if I just then take this back to that position over here, you can see I can actually tilt and lift the tool even more so that I can get closer, depending on limitation of where the tool needs to move to, is dependent on where you place the tilt curve. So that's always something to bear in mind, the exact position of the tilt curve. That's quite important. But what we would like to really cover on this situation as well is the fact that when I open up the toolbar, if you can remember in the first toolbar where we have used the software to do the thinking for us, we've actually used gauge checking. Now, in the one that I've used, I'm doing now, in this area here, in the gauge check, I don't even have to use it, because me as the user are controlling that tool completely, taking the control away by controlling it with the tool curve. So you have less things to check against. And that normally creates a quicker calculation time as well, because the software don't have to think as much or have to regenerate and reprocess positioning. So there's a lot of benefits by using the tilt curve, and this is just one of them. So now that we have that tilt curve explained, and you can see the clear tool motion, we now have the perfect cycle, and we have the perfect result. But I want to use the cycle over and over, and I don't want to keep doing the same settings. Now this is where EdgeCam really comes into play, and this is where we call it's called an EdgeCam mask, which is an EdgeCam cycle that you minimize or you redevelop for yourself as a user, and then create your own cycle from that cycle, which is very unique to EdgeCam. And that's what we want to show now in the next bit of this exercise. Now, as mentioned with the EdgeCam masks, that can be achieved with any cycle. You can do masking in any of EdgeCam cycles, whether it's 5-axis, 3-axis, turning, anything. You can mask any cycle. Now, we are looking at the 5-axis, and in the 5-axis, I have renamed my actual 5-axis cycle to a surface milling cycle. The reason I have renamed it for myself, which I will show you in a bit, is the fact that it only covers the surface area of advanced 5-axis, which is license dependent. So in the advanced 5-axis cycle area, we have got a situation where you have surfaces, and on the surfaces, you've got a variation of different patterns you can select from. Now in the 5-axis cycle, if I open up the cycle, now this is a custom cycle, it will open up first, which is a mask myself, I've created for myself. But over here, if I click on the three stripes, there is a range of different masks that I've created. So if I click on standard, which is the official cycle that you as a user, or we as a user get inside EdgeCam, and that is the cycle that you can now fully go and customize. Now to do customizations, we're not covering it in this video, but we will create some more videos for you where you can do some customization on cycles. And we do have already got some material content for it, if it's something of interest to you, and you can just reach out to us. So over here, we have all the strategies set and milling types, depth areas, tool access control, the check options, the leads, the links, the feed rates, the multiple passes, and all those kind of things, and transformation and rotation, things like that. But for myself, I want to customize the cycle exactly to a method that I can use moving forward for any undercut machine or any where I would like to use the toolpath as discussed beforehand on the other cycles moving forward. Now let's look at that. So if I cancel this, or I can not actually cancel it, over here I can just pick the mask that I've created, but I'm not going to do that because I've created a customized area again in EdgeCam, which is great, that you can create as many customizations in the customized ribbon, and you can add and replace things like that. So I've created me one, and I've called it the 5-axis cycle. So this is 5-axis only. And the one that I've used is the 5-axis blending between two curves. So if I select that cycle, it will open up this mask that I've created in the background. And it will only be dependent on the blend between two curves surface strategy, which I have used. So if I cancel this and I open up the actual cycle, now with the cycle, I can control direction, I can control my cuts, exact surfaces, number of cuts, cut order, round corners, if I want to put a comment, tool shift, I want to shift the tool in any direction. Tap, I can go same clearance plane. Tool axis control is where we get into. So in the tool axis control area, we are using two curve. And again, we are using closest point. Now, what I can do, I can reselect the geometry input and say okay. And it asks me to select my first curve, which is the upper curve. It asks me to select the second curve, which is the lower curve. Then it asks me if I want to use a start point, because I've got it active in the cycle. And if I don't want to use a start point, I just right click and it ignores it. Then it asks me to pick the tilt curve, which is the curve that we've used beforehand. That's 10 mil off and 30 mil away from that original curve. Asks me to select the drive surface. If I right click again, now it's asked me for the check surface. So to save me some unnecessary calculation, I just ignore the check surface because I have full control of how this tool will behave because of the tilt curve that I created. I'm just going to right click and straight away calculate it in seconds. Now, if I simulate this toolpath, I get the full motion of how the tool will come in, tilt away around that scenario or this situation where we have the problem. And now, by having this mask EdgeCam cycle for myself, I can now use this moving forward on any blend between two curves scenarios for any ball nose and things like that. I do not have to go back and use the advanced 5-axis cycle, because I've masked the original 5-axis cycle for me to cover some of these areas in the surface style. And that's a great winner moving forward for myself as a user in EdgeCam. So I have constructive cycles on any scenario. And again, there's no limitation on how many masks or cycles you can create for yourself within EdgeCam. Because if I click on the drop-down box, you can see I've already created a few more. I can create engraving cycles, I can create chamfering cycles, I can name them what I want, I can do with them what I want. And that gives you as a user great control over the amount of cycles you would like to have for yourself inside EdgeCam. So we do hope you find this video well, and any other questions, feel free to reach out to us at Hexagon.